too much. Go back to your seats. Morning. How are y'all doing? I'm going to open up with a little bit of scripture this morning. This is Psalm 115. This is what it says. It says, "Not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to your name goes all the glory, for your unfailing love and your faithfulness." I don't know what might have happened this morning and on your journey here or whatever, or what's on your mind or what's on your heart, but just remember that the only reason we are here is to praise His name and to glorify Him this morning. It's not about us. It's not about us as the praise band. It's not about you as the congregation. It's about all of us together worshiping the Lord. His name is all the glory.
Is planted on the streams of our mind.
see all these kids pouring in. You sit in the back, like most Baptists do, missing out on this one.
Thank you. walk around carrying these huge loads, whether it's guilt or just trials that we're walking through. And it says, let me at thy throne of mercy, where I'll just bow down and find that sweet relief that comes only from Christ and from Christ alone. So let's really worship this morning. If you feel comfortable, raise your hand. Let's close our eyes and not worry about what's going on around us. But let's really sing this morning. Savior, Savior, do not pass me by, because I don't know about you, but I need a touch from the Lord this morning. And I'm hungry for him, and I want to feel his touch this morning. So let's sing that verse again.
doing this morning? Thank you. Thank you. It is so good to be back with you. My name's Dave. I'm the pastor here at Antioch. I have been on a journey. I'm telling you, it was quite eventful. Hey, how you guys doing? You guys doing good? You guys want to see some pictures? Yeah, cool. I'm going to show you some. You were missing me? I missed you too, buddy. Thank you. You know, while I was gone, Laura and I celebrated 10 years of absolute marital bliss. And so give it up for her for putting up for me with that long. I love you so much. And you complete me. I love you so much. And my birthday, I turned 31 in Texas. And so, you know, the metabolism really slows down after 30. I'm just going to let you know. I think I may be the first person in the history of humanity to gain weight in a third world country. But it happened. I don't know how it happened. But, you know, getting in that plane seat, have you ever flown in those? Who are they making these seats for at the airline? I mean, I had to have somebody push me down into it. I'm telling you. That's not true, but close enough. But anyway, it's so great to be back with you. We're going to get the presentation rolling. Is it okay if I show you some pictures? You guys want to hear about India? Yeah. I'm telling you, we had an amazing time. The Lord is just doing some awesome things around the world, and He's doing them through you. The Bible says, Jesus told the disciples, if somebody gives you a cup of cold water in my name, they will share in the blessing.
Amen.
So you share in the missionary's blessing. What we did, you were doing with me. You were with me, and just be glad that you were actually here while I was there, because I'm telling you, it was hot. It was muggy. It was over 100 degrees, and it smelled all the time. It was just a smell in the city. But I'm telling you, we have got a huge mission field there. I don't know if you know this or not, but there are 1.25 billion people in India. That's a lot of people. If you want to know how many a billion is, imagine this. Imagine stacking $1 bills from Earth to the moon. That's a billion, estimated. That's about a billion. That's how many people there are in India. And there are more unreached people groups in India than any other part of the world. India is 90% Hindu. The Hinduism is the leading religion. 7% Muslim. 1.5% Christian. Then there's Shintoism, there's Buddhism, there's some other Eastern religions. But I'm telling you, I want to see India catch fire with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that's why I was serving with the Bridge Foundation. Who remembers Jason Hamilton, who came and spoke here earlier this year? If you go to the next slide, this is actually a slide from his PowerPoint. That this is what Jason had in his heart to do with the Bridge Foundation. And a Bridge Foundation is just a grassroots missions organization. I'm on the board of it. There's five of us from college. And we said, you know what? We want to see the indigenous people of Southeast Asia reaching their own people for Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
It's good to go, but I'm telling you, if we can just equip, there are people there who are believers, who love the Lord, they just don't have the resources we have. Jason shared this need for us, and I want to let you know, we paid for over half of this project. Amen. Over half of the pastor's conference, that came from you. That came from this building. That came from this room. And so I just want to let you know there, and we didn't even have to take an offering. We put a basket at the back. You responded, you gave, and then go to the next slide. And we took India by force, baby. That's me and Jason. I brought him flowers. That's a cultural greeting for when you're at the airport. So I bought some flowers, and I didn't have a pillow, and his flight was delayed, so I slept on them. So they're kind of, you know, you do what you gotta do, you know. I was so jet lagged. I flew 7.5 hours into the future. I flew into tomorrow. Can you believe that? That's pretty cool, isn't it? But I was so messed up, I couldn't even walk straight. I didn't know where I was. I didn't know what time it was. I'm so glad that there's an app on this phone that says World Clock. Because that's the only way that kept me going. We went to Raipur, India. We did a pastor's conference. This is where we were. And Chhattisgarh is the state. Raipur is the city. And that city on next to it, Orissa, is where the majority of these pastors came from. This is where they're ministering. They're ministering in remote places that are heavily persecuted, that are not open to the gospel. And so what we did was we held a 4-day conference. I want you to see some of Raipur. Go to the next slide. There are cows everywhere. Cows are considered sacred beings. So it's ironic to me because there are people that are starving in the streets, and I'm thinking, look, you got dinner right there by that Range Rover. It is eating the garbage. But look, that's the Hinduism belief system, is that they believe in reincarnation. So when you die, if you lived a good life, you will come back into the next life as a higher life form. And that's at the top of the chain, cows. That's the first thing I wanted on my plate when I got back into America. I'm telling you, what a depressing religion. I mean, you can shoot for a little bit higher than dinner. You know, you can be something better. But this is the belief system that they have been in since 1500 BC. And so another thing about India, which is kind of messed up, we wouldn't have it here in America, but they have a caste system. And so you're born within a certain level of society. They believe it's your obligation to stay within that level of society and to function there. So if you're born poor, you're going to stay poor. At the top of the food chain is Brahmin. They get first rights. They get first dibs at universities. They get first dibs at all the best jobs. They get the cream of the crop. It's based on this caste system. That was one of the things that I was preaching, was that Jesus Christ breaks the caste system. Because of the blood of Christ, we are all equal at the cross. Amen. It's a powerful message that we have to speak to the rest of the world. Go to the next slide. This was a traffic jam. That's a herd of goats. I did eat a lot of goat in India, and I couldn't tell the difference between that and chicken. I'm just saying, I don't know. Everything is spicy. Even breakfast is spicy. The milk they serve, they put onions in the milk. Yeah, I'm telling you, think about that. I'm telling you, you know, and it's customary. You eat what you're given. So, you know, you take that sip in the... I'm okay. I'm all right. I chugged that thing down. I don't know how I didn't lose my lunch. But I took an Imodium at every meal because I refused to use the squatty potty. But anyway, go to the next. These are homes along the sidewalk. They're built out of whatever they can get their hands on. This is a neighborhood. This is like Antioch Glen in India. I want you to look at that. On the side of the road, built out of whatever they can find. There is extreme poverty everywhere. There are some wealthy people, all the government jobs, like I said, there are big houses right next to shacks just like this. Go to the next slide, if you would. Here's some more homes. That right there on the ground, they take the home down during the day and they pitch it back up at night just so they have something to sleep under. People living on the streets, not striving for anything better. Remember, this is what they're told, that it's their obligation to live within this system. Go to the next slide. She's doing laundry. She's washing in a bucket and she's getting water out of the gutter. This is every day. This was every day we see this. Hundreds and thousands of people that are living like this. Go to the next. Here's a market. You can buy some pottery there, some festive stuff. Go to the next slide. There's a stormtrooper right there. She's riding on her motorcycle. People everywhere dress like this. It's a religious thing. They also do it practically to keep the dust out of their face. There are motorbikes everywhere. And there are lanes and there are stoplights, but they mean absolutely nothing. It is get as fast as you can get without dying. That's the plan when you get in the car. And there's cows and livestock, and you cannot hit a cow. They will kill you if you hit a cow. Go to the next slide. This is handmade scaffolding. This is how they build their scaffolding. They lash bamboo together with rope. Some of this goes hundreds of feet up in the air. This is how they use. Is Trix here? Somebody email him. Can you imagine operating like that? I mean, it would take you a month just to set up the job site. They hand build their scaffolding like this. Oh, okay. Well, we don't got to tie it, though. But go to the next one. This was the front page news. They lynched a man because he killed a cow to feed his family. They found out he killed a cow, and they hung him in the middle of town. So this is what we were dealing with. I just want you to get a picture. How many of you know when you go home today and you get to eat Fruity Pebbles tomorrow morning, you should be thanking Jesus, all right? When you put a big T-bone steak on the plate this afternoon, glory to God. How many of you know God bless America?
Amen.
I'm just saying, we are so blessed and so privileged. Most of India is like this. Like I said, there are nice areas, but it's reserved for the top class, for the Brahmin. The people that are at the top of the caste system. Go to the next slide. This was what I saw when I arrived, and I got a chuckle out of this because I'm not a big title guy, but I'm Pastor Reverend David Vogt. And so, Steve, if you can make me a new name tag, that's what I would like for it to say. And then I was serving with Dr. Reverend Jason Hamilton. I think this is so cool because I'm from Orange, Virginia. I'm a nobody. I'm a guy that said, Lord, if you can do something with a loser like me, do it. And look at where I'm at 31, plump, healthy, hallelujah, serving the Lord all over the world.
Amen.
And here's the cool thing about this. I didn't have to spend a dime to go on this trip. When Jason was here and he was sharing the vision for this seminar, I said, man, I think I should go with you. And then we had a singly lady and they said, well, if you want to go, we got your airfare. And then the Deacon Fellowship gave me $1,500 to go. You guys are amazing. While I was gone, y'all did an amazing outreach to the rescue squad. Give it up. Where's Angela Bishop at? There she is. Everyone who helped with that. We had the JRBA meeting here Thursday night. Do you know what they said about that association? They said it was the best association meeting they had ever had. And Miss Earlene Smith, June Allen, Judy Carter, where's Sharon Rittenhouse? Margaret Rittenhouse, Sharon Pace, these ladies that just pulled together and made this thing happen. I just can't tell you how proud I was when I'm looking on Facebook and I'm seeing Antioch ministering while I'm ministering. This is what it's all about, guys. This is what it's all about. You guys are the ministers. We did this seminar. We brought in 45 pastors from all over those rural regions. Many of those pastors, you know how they became a pastor? They were the first person saved. And so they hand him a Bible and say, all right, go start a church. Can you imagine? No membership class. No discipleship process. No Sunday school. You go. And so we brought these men together. Go to the next slide. There's the doctor and I. They gave us these flower arrangements when we got there. They presented them to us. That's an Indian thing, I guess. I don't know. Go to the next slide. This is where we rented out this building, and this is where they stayed. This is the hallway. Go to the next slide. They slept on the floor, 5 or 6 to a room. We rented out this Hindu compound so that we could have our seminar there. And these guys were happy. These guys were joyful. They weren't complaining because there was no room service. They didn't complain about there not being a continental breakfast. They were just glad to get together for the body of Christ. Go to the next slide. There's another picture. Looks like a crime scene in there. I don't know what happened. I was just taking pictures after the fact. But man, we packed 6-7 men into these rooms. Go to the next one. Let me show you. Now, this is why I took an Imodium at every meal. If you don't know what this is the restroom. If you're looking for the toilet paper, there isn't any. All right, this is a hole in the ground with 2 places for your feet. That's how you go. And, you know, don't miss. You know, you got to hit it. And then there's the bucket of water, and you just wash up at the end. That's the way it rolls. So I'm just telling you, when I got home, I'm telling indoor plumbing, praise the Lord. Right? When you go home today and you use your bathroom, you can say, think about how privileged we are. Think about how blessed we are. The Lord has blessed us. And with that blessing comes a high responsibility. All right, go to the next slide. And after they, you know, there was no toilet paper, and then they eat with their hands. There's no silverware, whatever you call it. There's no utensils. You eat with your right hand, and you just mash it all together, and it just goes in, right? So this is how we ate. And I didn't get sick. Isn't that wonderful? God is good. God is good. Took care of us. Go to the next slide. And this is the time. I want to tell you something. You want to talk about worship. The morning session started at 9:30 a.m. They had devotions at 6 o'clock in the morning before that. They didn't come pick us up till 11 o'clock. When we got there, we worshiped for another hour. The morning session's supposed to stop at 12:30. We went till 3:30 in the afternoon. They worshiped for 3-4 hours at a time. And then you pray, and then you pray for an hour. And then they want you to preach for at least an hour. If I couldn't bring it for an hour, they would just tell me, hey, can you stand back up? Can you go for one more hour on this topic? I don't think that would ever happen here in Antioch. I don't think that would, hey, Dave, you've only preached for 45 minutes. Can you preach for another hour? I couldn't do it. This is why you should send me here once a year. Get it out of my system. All right. Go to the next slide. This is just pictures of them worshiping, praising God. There were no instruments the first day. It was just all the instruments came later. They got a keyboard, and I don't think the guy who was playing it had any idea what he was doing. He's just hitting keys, just trying to find it. They had some drums, just banging on the drums. But I'm telling you, the sound of the worship of these men, they were just going all out for God. They were going wild for the King of Kings because they don't have anything else. They don't have any other form of entertainment to distract them from worship. And we shouldn't let it distract us either, but I'm not preaching yet. Go to the next slide. This is they're sitting down, eager to learn. And if you're wondering why many of them, you'll see them in the same outfits, is because they have one good outfit. And they wore it every time. But as soon as the session was over, everybody changed right to their pajamas. It's a nap culture, and I really like that. If we can incorporate that here in America, from 2 to 4 p.m. is nap time for everyone. I liked it. It was nice. Go to the next slide. There's me preaching and Buff's waving his hanky. There, that's him holding the handkerchief in the background. Go to the next slide. And this is us. This is, like I said, we would preach a message and then just sit down, and then they talk back and forth, and they would say, "This is a really interesting topic, Brother Dave. Can you preach for one more hour on this?" This is what we had to do after every message. All right, what the heck am I going to talk about for the next hour? But I'm telling you, the Holy Spirit, we talked about faith from every angle. Because we are so dependent on what we have. Many of us, we rarely ever get to the point of living on faith. Because we're so dependent on what we see. But these men, I'm talking, these guys are building schools, and the villagers will burn them down right after they build them. So that's why they built the next one with cinder block. You know, they got smarter. Work smarter, not harder, right? Cinder block doesn't burn as easily. The pastor that we were with, Pastor Joshua, man, he had his brother killed. They were preaching together in Odisha, and they killed his brother. And instead of stopping, Joshua continued to preach. And not only did Joshua continue to preach, but some of the men that they were preaching to said, "We want to follow this Jesus. He's worth dying for. We want to follow him." And so they let Joshua live because they said, "If we kill him, we'll just make another martyr." But these men have given up their lives. Many of these men that I'm preaching to about faith experience beatings, imprisonments, all these types of things that we've never had to even think about. And I'm sitting there thinking, God, what do I have to tell these men about faith? They're living examples of faith every day. But the Lord used us. We encouraged them, and we were hitting the books. Go to the next slide. This is a picture of all of us together. Pastor Joshua is in between. I'm the handsome one there on your right, my left. And then you see the Dr. Hamilton there. And Pastor Joshua in the middle. This is really cool because Pastor Joshua sat under Dr. Hamilton, Jason's teaching in Malaysia. Joshua came to Malaysia and sat under some Bible school training from Jason. Joshua goes back, the only preacher, and now there's 45 preachers there. He started with one, now there's 45. Our vision is to raise up 100 to reach 10,000. And I'm telling you, Antioch, we have a part to play in this. This is, God has put this need right in our lap. And I just want to encourage you, let's keep going. Next year, I've talked to Malcolm Warfield. Next year, we're going to put in some gardens in their villages. I want to take 10 of you with me to India. I want to take 10 of you. Aaron, if you're 16, you can go, if your mother says okay. Got to ask her. Bring her too. But look, this is what we're called to be, guys. She's shaking her head. Not going. But hey, I'm telling you, this is, have we already been given a command to go or not? Didn't Jesus say go? I mean, I don't know about you. I want to see Jesus before I die. What did he say? The gospel of the kingdom must be preached as a sign to the ends of the earth, and then the end would come. What are we waiting for? What are we waiting for? They love selfies, by the way. We took like 10 selfies with each individual. My face was frozen like this, you know? You know that point where you've been smiling so long, it's not even a smile, you're just showing your teeth, you know? They love selfies. Go to the next slide. We prayed over each and every one of them after every session individually. This took about an hour to 2 hours. We prayed over them. We were praying and encouraging them, challenging them. Each one of them wanted to be prayed for because they know where the power comes from. And I've already gotten. They held a revival service last week in Odisha, and Pastor Joshua said that they saw several healings taking place in the villages. Several people coming to Christ because these men stepped out in faith and went back to their villages and began to preach. That's a good place to say amen. Amen. Nothing is impossible with God. Go to the next slide. This is Pastor Joshua's ministry. It's Peniel Rescue Ministries. I want to show you some of the things that they're doing if you go to the next slide. This is their children's church. They don't have a building right now. They're meeting outside. And you see how nicely they're sitting, nice and quiet? Take notes, guys. Take notes, right? All right, go to the next slide. This is the night service that they held after our training. Packed. Said there were hundreds of people that came. Many people were healed. Many people gave their hearts to Christ. They're doing the work immediately, right after we said, because that's one of the things we said, all right, after we do this conference, it's time for you to go back and start doing the work. And they did. They held a night conference. They're meeting outside. Go to the next slide. This is the building that they're building. And like I said earlier, the deacons gave me $1,500 for this trip. $700 is putting a roof on that building. There's going to be a roof on this building by the end of the month. As long as everybody shows up to work. It doesn't always happen. We know what that's like. $500 went to the Bridge Foundation. And $300 went to Visa and Passport. And I just want to say again, thank you guys so very much for all that you have done to send me on this trip. Go to the next slide. This is their women's prayer meeting. They have this every Sunday morning before service. The women get together and pray for 2 hours before the service starts. On their knees, crying out to God. I told Buff, I said, man, if I could get 10 women to put the phone down and come and start a prayer meeting, come on, somebody. What kind of revival would break out? Go to the next slide. Got awful quiet on that one. This is their property. This is where, hopefully, Lord willing, please be praying. We're trying to work out some details on irrigation and water because it is a little bit dry, but this is where next year we're going to put in those gardens. Be praying, because I'm telling you, I want to take some of you with me. We're going to put their garden in. We're going to keep paying it forward. We're going to continue. It's all about not just putting a check in the plate, but letting God use us to have a real impact in a real place with real people. This is what Antioch is called to do. You remember Antioch in the book of Acts? It was a church that sent out missionaries. The Lord put a vision in my heart in 20 years. We want to send out 200 missionaries from this place. Let that sink in. Where are they at? Maybe right here. Maybe it's you. One of the pastors that was at this pastor's conference was 88 years old. He traveled over 300 miles to be there. And he was ready to preach. Come on, guys. We've got a mission. We've got a job to do. Where are they at? 200 missionaries in 20 years. That's only, what, 20 a year? Hands, is that right? 10 a year? Yeah, my math is terrible. 10 a year. Who's going to be our first one? Who's going to be our first one? Pray about it. Mike, I would love for you to go. I hope you go and change the world. We got to stop thinking outside of these walls and start thinking about changing the world. Because that's what Christ told us to do. We get so small-minded. We get so wrapped up in our everyday lives. Get there in a minute. Go to the next slide. This is for extra credit. This is me drinking a thumbs up cola. They don't have Coke or Pepsi. They thumbs up. So go to the next slide. When we got to Texas, I was busy in Texas. I just want to let you know, somebody asked me how my vacation was, and it was great, but I preached 9 times in 16 days. I just want to let you know, I was working. I was working my butt off. For you guys, because I take it very seriously that you sent me. I preached a message in Texas, was able to raise $400 for the Bridge Foundation at Soma Church in Tyler, Texas. And if you go to the next slide, I went to the modern day missions banquet. Who remembers Marvin Slayton? Anybody remember Marvin? He came here and preached. He's the president of modern day missions. I went to their missions banquet, and there was a church there that was a small Baptist church in Texas called Shady Grove Baptist Church. And a man named Olin Griffin went there to pastor in 1974. And that one church, over 45 of the 233 missionaries that modern day supports came from Shady Grove Baptist Church. 45 missionaries from one place. Why? Because a group of people said, we are going to obey the word of the Lord. Nothing is stopping us but us. God has called us to go. He's called us to go. And I don't know if you remember, when Marvin was here, modern day only had 201 missionaries. In just a few months, he was here in July, they had 233 missionaries now. And I've been talking, I don't know if you know this or not, but I've been talking with the BGAV officials in Richmond. The IMB is taking 800 missionaries off of the field. 800 missionaries are having to come off the field because there's no support. Some of them want to come, but many of them don't. And so we're in talks with that. I want to see Antioch Baptist Church partnering with modern day missionaries. And if there are any of those 800 missionaries that want to stay on the field, we'll send them. All it takes is faith. All it takes is a little bit of faith and a little bit of money. But these things should not be declining. These things should not be declining, guys. Lou Engle was the guest speaker. He runs a ministry called The Call, which leads teenagers to fast and pray. Now, I don't know if you have teenagers. Can you imagine teenagers fasting and praying? This is a miracle in and of itself. I know my kids are always hungry, and whenever I have your kids over, they're always hungry. It's a prayer movement of young people, and he was sharing a message, and this is what he said. He said, it is time for the call to become the sent. And it hit me like a lightning bolt, because the message that the Lord gave me before coming to Antioch Baptist Church was, you are called, equipped, and sent. Do you remember that message? Called, equipped, and sent. So answer, prepare, and go. This has got to become more than just words on a sign. Love, connect, go, grow has got to become more than just a statement. This has to become who we are about. If you'll open in your Bibles to Matthew, I'm going to just talk about two verses. Matthew chapter 9. We're going to look at two quick verses. While I was on the plane flying back from India, I was tired, I was wore out, I was beat. I was exhausted. I just wanted a cold beverage, and I wanted to sleep for 14 hours. That's all I wanted. I wanted a steak, but I had to wait till I got back to America for that. But I'm sitting there on the plane, and I asked for the seat in the exit row because there's more room. Nobody sits in the middle seat, and then there's this nice Indian gentleman that sits on the corner aisle seat. And so I'm just buckled my seatbelt. I'm in an upright position. I'm ready to go, right? And I do this thing, you know, I'm just trying to sleep. And he starts talking to me. And I'm like, hello, what? What do you want? He's like, oh, yeah, how are you doing? I said, oh, I'm good, I'm really tired. He said, oh, what have you been doing? He starts asking me all these questions. I said, oh, well, I'm with a... Now, I was real generic, because that's what Buff told me. He said, just don't be real vocal about you're a pastor and you're here to make converts. They frown on that sort of thing in this part of the world. So I said, I'm here just doing a training for a nonprofit organization, doing philanthropy and good works. You know, he says, okay, is it a Christian organization? yes, it's a Christian organization. He says, oh, well, I'm a pastor. I live here in Mumbai, which is the largest city in India. It used to be Bombay. Now it's Mumbai. And he starts talking to me about all this stuff, and I'm like, well, great, now I'm not going to get any sleep, you know. He's talking to me, and I'm like, oh, well, that's great, you know. I do the turn. I do this thing. You know, I'm showing my back because I'm wanting just to sleep. And he... What is your problem, man? Can't a brother just get some sleep on the plane? And he says, you have a nice nap, but there are some things that the Lord wants me to share with you when we get to the airport. I'm like, oh gosh, right. What is this? Lord, I've been working for you nonstop. I said, okay, yeah, great. Go to sleep. Turn over. We land. My first thought is, how am I going to lose this guy? I've got to lose him in the airport. I've got to get away from him. Look, I felt like Jonah. You know what I mean? Like, I'm trying to get away. The Lord, I'm like, I've done, God. I did what you called me to do. I just want to relax. And so first thing, you know, he's waiting for me when I get off the plane. You know, I'm walking slowly. Oh, there he is. Roll on over. So we're walking. I see a bathroom. I say, hey, man, look, I've been holding it for like 6 days. I got to go. I'll catch you later. So I lose him in the bathroom. And before I come out, I'm like, look, you know, is this guy gone yet? So I go to the big screens to find my next flight. And it's not there. I'm like, what in the world? I know it leaves. I'm looking at my boarding pass. It's not there. So I have to go to the information desk to find out what gate I'm at. Well, I round the corner to get to the information desk, and this guy's standing at the information desk. And oh, brother, okay. So, you know, his flight wasn't on the board either. So, you know, the lady tells him, sir, you're in gate C11. He starts walking away. I go up. I tell her my flight. She says... So I said, all right. He said, let me tell you what. I know you Americans love coffee. Let me buy you coffee. So then we walk and we go to this coffee shop and we sit down. I preached on Hebrews chapter 11. This man sits next to me and he says, I feel like the Lord he shares Hebrews chapter 11 with me. Talking about the faith of Abraham and the faith of Noah. And I'm like, man, I just preached all this. I preached on Psalm 23. He starts sharing me about Psalm 23. Hey, the Lord has prepared a table for you in the presence of your enemies. The Lord is at the table. You need to keep your eyes on the Lord. I just preached that. What are you talking about? I preached on 2 Corinthians chapter 5. We are ambassadors for Christ. This man looks at me and he says, you are an ambassador for Christ. He starts sharing 2 Corinthians. I'm like, what in the world? I start crying. He says, never let that church get in maintenance mode. You are called to live in missions mode. You are an ambassador of Christ. He's sharing these things with me. I know, man. It's so great. I just felt the presence of God in the middle of Doha, in the middle of the airport. We're sitting there over coffee. And this man, whom I've never met, is sharing all these things with me. All these things that I just preached to 45 other men. And he's sharing them with me. And he says, the greatest danger that you have in America is getting comfortable and getting complacent. Because we have so many things to distract us from the mission that God has given. How many of this man had my attention? How many, you don't know what I'm talking about? You ever been in that situation when God just gets your attention? Many of you have sat in sermons just like this and you say, man, Dave, you're preaching right to me. No, I'm not. The Lord is talking to you. The Lord is talking to you. Antioch, we cannot get in maintenance mode. We are not called to preserve the grounds. We are called to storm the gates of hell. Amen. We are called to be the church. Whatever God says goes. And whatever has to change to accomplish the mission that he gives, we change. Amen. Why? Because we are his ambassadors. Don't you know what an ambassador does? An ambassador represents the person that sends them, right? The ambassador has all the authority and power of who has sent them. Who has sent us? Jesus Christ has sent us. Jesus Christ has sent us. It says, go and make disciples. Matthew chapter 9, at verse 35, I just want to read this passage, and then we're going to talk about it for a few minutes, and we're going to close. Everyone's like, yeah, right, a few minutes, sure. Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. But when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion for them because they were weary and scattered like sheep having no shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, he says, the harvest truly is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Jesus is finishing up a time of ministry in this Galilean region. He preaches. It says he heals every kind of disease, every kind of sickness. You know what he does after that moment? He doesn't sit back and say, "Man, I am a good God." Right? So many times after we have a great religious experience, we see God do something, we're like, "Man, isn't that great?" And we sit back. What does Jesus do? He's done all this ministry. He has healed all these sick people. And then he looks out at the multitudes and he has compassion. He says, "Man," he says, "look, the harvest is plentiful." You ever been driving down Route 6 when the corn gets about this high? The harvest, right? You know it's about time. What does that mean? What does the harvest mean? It means it's about time to bring all that corn in, doesn't it? You can see if Jesus is looking at it, and he says, "The harvest is plentiful." All right, see y'all later. Guess y'all are leaving. Bye. Bye. Love you. He looks out at the harvest, and he's saying, "Look, the harvest is plentiful." You know what? I think that we need to get back to the point. We need to remember when we walk out of this place, what are we seeing? Are you just seeing that job that you have to go back to? Are you just seeing that school day that you've got to do, that family function? We've got all these things. We need to get back to the point where we walk out and we see the harvest. Those coworkers that you're working with, man, the people that you're rubbing shoulders with, the people in your school, the people on your job, this is the harvest. We got to get back to the point where we walk out and we're moved with compassion because we see, man, these people are harassed. They're ruining their lives. They're empty. They're lost. Man, we've gotten so obsessed with stuff. We've gotten so obsessed with our religion. We've gotten so obsessed with our to-do list. Man, the harvest, look, the harvest is plentiful all around us. It's ready to be taken in for the glory of God. Jesus sees this and he's moved with compassion. And I don't think he just saw the multitudes in front of him. I think he saw the multitudes of people, 2+ billion people on this planet right now, the same planet that you're on and I'm on, 2 billion people that don't know Jesus. I was talking with people in the market, they didn't know who Jesus was. We know who Jesus is and we choose to ignore him, but there's 2 billion people who don't even know his name. He's looking out and he's like, "Look, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few." The problem isn't with the abundance of sin in the world. We know the world in its present form is what? It's passing away. We know that wickedness is going to increase. We know that in the last days, the love of many is going to grow cold. We know that the Antichrist is coming. We know that we're racing towards the end. The problem isn't with the harvest. The problem is there aren't enough laborers. Who are the laborers of God? It's you. That's why he put his spirit in you. That's why he saved you and redeemed you. Why? So that you can go reap the harvest. He looks out and he says, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few." Verse 38, then it has this really big word. It says, "Therefore," in the New King James, NIV says, "Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore." He gives us an action point. What do we do about all this harvest and not enough laborers? He didn't say, "Therefore, form a committee." Did he say that? He didn't say, "Therefore, assimilate into denominations." He didn't say, "Therefore, start a Sunday school program." Nothing wrong with those things. But that's not what Jesus said. What does he say? He says, "Therefore, pray." And it's not just, "Now I lay me down to sleep." It's pray. The word that in the Greek means to beg, to plead. It's an imperative. It's a command. It's a command from Jesus Christ for us to pray. We got so many reasons and so many excuses, and our schedules are so full, and we don't like it this way, and we don't like it. Listen, all of that's got to put, we are called to pray. This is the command of the Lord. Can't you do that? Who in here knows how to pray? desperate for something? This is talking about a desperate plea to beg, Lord Jesus, please send out laborers into the harvest. He says, therefore, pray to the Lord of the harvest. Notice Jesus in this verse. He's the Lord of the harvest. So he's in control of the harvesting. What is this? This means, guys, he is Lord. He is in control. If we move in obedience, he will send his spirit. He will send his provision. He will send what we need. All we need to do is walk in obedience. But if we're going to sit here and cross our arms and say, well, we're not going to do this with that, and we can't do this with that, and we got to say this, and we got to keep this way, what are we doing? What are we doing? Ask, therefore, pray that the Lord of the harvest would do what? Send forth laborers. Send them, right? I think we say something around here that God saved you to what? Send you. Now this word send is so interesting because the Greek word is ekbalo. It's normally used, it's used 82 times in the New Testament. Normally it's used when Jesus cast out a demon. He ekbaloed a demon. Now Jesus doesn't politely ask demons to leave. He casts out demons. Amen? This is what he says he will do. If we will pray to the Lord of the harvest, if we will beg and plead and ask. But you know what the catch is? You can't ask him to do something or to send someone if you're not willing to go yourself. This is where the rubber meets the road. We don't want to leave our luxury. We don't want to leave our comfort. We don't have to squat the poop. I know what it's like. The struggle is real. Listen, ask therefore that he will send, he will cast forth laborers. He's given us the means to meet the mission. All we got to do is ask him to send out laborers, and we're going to be willing to go. If we'll get serious about asking, Lord, whatever you want to do with this property at 4422 Antioch Road, you can do. Whatever you want to move around, you can move around. Whatever you want to renovate, you can renovate. Whoever you want to send, you can send. You know the Moravian church, the Moravians, Count Zinzendorf, we're going back several hundred years now. You know what they did every year? They tithed their congregation to missions. Isn't that radical? So listen, if we had 100 people, I can do this math, Hans. If we had 100 people here, at the end of the year, 10 are going to the mission field. Every year. And you know what? They never had to require anyone to go. They always had a volunteer. What radical, simple obedience. And you know what? Maybe you're not able to go. Maybe you're not physically able to go. But everyone in this room is physically able to pray. There is not a person sitting here that cannot ask the Lord of the harvest to cast laborers into the field. The word's ekbalo. Lord, I want the Lord to ekbalo 10 of you this year or next year into the mission field. Look, the mission boards are failing. The way we used to do it's not working anymore. Maybe God wants to go back to a really old way, and that really old way is my church sends forth my missionaries. And that is that what happened in the book of Acts? I mean, are we reading the same book? Can I see your Bible? Who's open to Matthew chapter 9? Can I see your Bible? I just want to make sure. Yeah, ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. All right, we're reading this thing. Can I see your Bible? Does your Bible say anything different than mine? So pray to the Lord who is in charge of the harvest and ask him to send more workers into his. Does your Bible say what I'm saying? Guys, it's time for us to say, you know what? We're so grateful for our heritage. God bless our heritage. God bless who we are. And I'm telling you, God is using this church to impact our entire association. We had people in this room Thursday night that were awed by what God is doing here. And the guy who was preaching said, look, all of our churches are dying. Well, except for Antioch. Praise God!
Amen.
What God wants to do here in this place, what He wants to do through you, He wants to send you out to bring in the harvest. Drew Pay said, I was texting him. I'm going to pick on you just for a second. I love you. This is what he said to me. He says, man, Dave, I would love to go on a missions trip. I said, Drew, great news. On Monday morning, you're going to Fluvanna County High School. You're going on a missions trip Monday morning. Good news. Guess what, Kevin? When you go on that job site Monday morning, you're going on a mission. We are going into the harvest fields. And there's no difference between local and international missions. We are just on mission. It's here, it's across the street, it's around the world, but we gotta get to a place where we are stopped. We are not concerned with holding the fort. We are not concerned with maintaining the status quo. It is never enough until we see Jesus face to face. Going all out, putting it all on the line, spending every, what good does it do if we get raptured and go to heaven and we have $100,000 in the bank and we didn't have a plan? That terrifies me. I don't care if I lose my job tomorrow. I know the Lord will provide. But you know what what keeps me up at night is standing before the throne of God, standing before the King of Kings, and Him looking at me in the face and Him saying, why didn't you do something with everything that I gave you? This shakes me to the core of who I am. This is why we're here. This is why you're here this morning. The Lord is calling us to pray. I'm going to tell you. Tuesday morning, Hans Carter and I will be here from 6 a.m. to 7:30 a.m. to pray. Wednesday night, we will be here 6:30 p.m. to 8 p.m. to pray. And it's a new format. Nobody's telling you what to pray. You come in 6:30, you mingle, you get along with the Lord, you spend time with the Lord, then we come together at 7, we share, we edify one another. This is what the Lord showed me through His Word. This is what the Lord showed me. And then we pray together for the needs of the church. It's an hour and a half. Yes, you can pray at home. You can't, I'm not, anybody can pray at home, but there's something that happens. What happened when the apostles and the disciples and the 120 people in Acts chapter 2 got together in the same room and prayed? They were in one accord. You can't get around it. Right? 10 times in the book of Acts. One accord, one accord, one accord, one accord, one accord. Well, if we're going to get on one accord, at some point our agenda, our ideas, we have to be willing to lay them all at the feet of Jesus. You have to be willing to lay your life at the feet of Jesus. This is my offering to you. We sing Jesus Loves Me. Maybe it's time for us to start singing Jesus We Love You. Here are our lives. Send me wherever you want to send me. But He'll never send you to Africa. He'll never send you to Africa until you're faithful on Monday morning, wherever He sends you, whatever your job is, wherever your mission is, your family. Some of you, it's your family right now. That's your mission field. Listen, we're called to pray and ask the Lord of the harvest to send. This is what we're going to do. This is how we're going to end the service. We're going to pray together. Say, Lord, use us. There is no reason why God can't do it here at Antioch. There is nothing my God cannot do. He did not give us 22 acres of land to argue about renovating an old building. Come on, somebody. Who's got vision in this place? We've got the street. We've got the road front. Man, let's ask, Lord, use us in such a mighty way. Use us to impact this community. Does it bother anybody else that you drove by? How many people that are not coming here? Bothers me. Bothers me. Guys, we are, and this is not just a toe-stomping message. This is a special place. We have to understand, there are so many of you that are so committed, dedicated, praying, giving. We have given out. Do you realize this year we have given out 14,000 pounds of food to feed the hungry? Amen. From this place? Amen. 14,000 pounds of food from Antioch. That's a good place to say amen, people. Hello? Maybe I need to get back up here. 14,000 pounds of food.
Amen.
To this community. You know what I'm ready to celebrate? I'm ready to celebrate the year Antioch Baptist Church gives $1 million to missions. Can you dream that big? I'm ready to build a building, not so we can boast about our numbers, but we have a place from which to send laborers. God, you can come in this place and you can meet us and you can send any one of us whenever you're ready. And what would happen? And you know what the other churches in our association are saying? Man, I wish we had that. They were saying it Thursday night. I wish we had a worship team like that. Wow, look at that young drummer up there praising the Lord. There, look, God is using us to have an impact here. But He's called us to reach the nations. He's called us to reach the nations. You know where you start? How do I reach the nations? You start by praying to the Lord of the harvest. And then you reach out to your neighborhood this afternoon. Your neighbors. You reach them. You pray. You give. Come on, guys, man. We gave Lottie Moon $1,000 in 1984. We can do better than that. It's 2015. All I'm saying is there's going to be somebody in the room that says, here am I, send me. Here's my checkbook. Use it. There's going to be a couple Barnabases scattered throughout here that says, Lord, this is what you blessed me with. What if we got back to living within our means so that we could give the Lord our abundance? You don't ever have abundance until you learn to live within your means. I'm just challenging you. Worship team, come. We're going to pray. Jesus looked out. When we walk out of this place, do we see the harvest? Do we see the people that need to know the power of God? Are you willing to pray this morning? Are you willing to beg the Lord to send out laborers? This is what Jesus Christ, this is what our Lord and Savior commanded His disciples to do. Now let me ask you something. If you're a born-again believer, doesn't that make you a disciple of Christ? Aren't you a follower? Who's a follower of Christ in this room this morning? You say, I'm a follower of Christ. He's telling us to pray, to ask Him to send out, to cast out laborers into the field. Because the harvest is ready. It's ready. We got to get ready. The harvest is ready. We got to get ready. How did everyone just bow your heads for a moment. Take a moment to think about this. I'm so grateful. This is the, I'm telling you, what God is going to do from Antioch Baptist Church. He's done so much in this last year. So many people, so many of you have experienced the power, the transforming power of God. I want to talk to a few of us in the room this morning. You drifted in here today. You don't know Jesus. He's not your Lord and Savior. You're separated. You don't have the hope of eternal life. You don't have the peace of God. You're here today. None of us did our job. If you walk out the same way you came in, I want you to search your heart. You need to know Jesus Christ. He is moving on your heart. You feel Him tugging at you. The Holy Spirit of God is hovering you right now saying, come, my son. It's time for you to come home. It's time for you to come back into the family. You give your life to Him. He died on the cross. His blood was spilled to redeem your life from hell, to give you a home in heaven, and to give you a plan and a purpose on earth. He is here today. If that's you, if that's you, I want you to come this morning. I want you to come up to the front. When we stand and sing, don't sit there. Don't let this thing just pass. You may never get this opportunity again. And I'm telling you, I can see it. He is here. He is pulling you. He is saying, it is your time. He came to the earth to save you, and He saved you so that He could send you into the harvest. Now for everyone else in the room, I want you to search your heart. When are you going to make time pray this week, specifically, Lord, send out laborers. Send me out. Some of you got construction crews, every single one of them. Lord, send me out. Give me the words. Send me a new worker that loves you with all their heart. Come on, you gotta pray that the Lord will send them. You gotta be willing to go. One more thing I want you to think about while you're sitting there. Simple question. Whose house is this? Because if this is Jesus Christ's house, if we are his holy habitation, then he can do whatever he wants to do with it. And he's got big plans for it. Let that sink into your heart this morning. I know we are vested, we are attached, we have been here, we grew up here. Praise God. He wants to use this place to impact the nations and to transform this neighborhood. It takes obedience. If you're here today and you need Christ, come forward when we stand. And then after we stand, we're just going to take a few minutes. And I want you to pray this morning. You pray whatever the Lord puts on your heart. You ask, Lord, send out laborers. Send me. You start to pray. And then we're going to sing our last song and close. Stand to your feet. We're just going to begin to pray. Just close your eyes. Don't worry about anyone around you. Let's just begin to pray. Let's offer up to the Lord. Lord, send laborers into the harvest. Lord, use me. Use me tomorrow when I go to school, when I go to work, when I get on the phone this afternoon. Change me, oh God. Send out laborers into the field. If you're here this morning and you need to know Christ, come now. Don't wait. Don't delay. Don't worry about what anyone else thinks. This is eternity on the line. Take a step out and just come down. Just come on down. Come on, I want to hear a roar of prayer coming from this place. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we ask you, oh God. We plead with you, God. Lord, we need laborers in Scottsville. We need laborers. I pray, oh God. We just ask that you would send out people, Lord, that are so on fire. Lord, that don't care what the world thinks, that don't care about what they have to give up, that all they care about is reaching the lost with the gospel of Christ. Lord, use Antioch Baptist Church to impact the nations. Use it to impact the neighborhood. Help us, oh God. Change our mindsets, oh God. Lord, have your way with this property. Have your way with this building. Have your way in this congregation. Move by the power of your Holy Spirit, oh God. Help us to see the harvest and stop seeing all the nitpicky things that are distracting us. Help us to see what you saw. Move us with compassion. People who are harassed without a shepherd, they need you. You are the great shepherd. Change us, transform us, oh God. Renew us, oh God. Do a work in this place. Lord, I want everyone in this community to look and say, can you believe what is happening in Antioch? This place is known for, we want this place to be known as a place where God hangs out. This is where you bring missionaries, you send missionaries, you set the captives free, you set people free from alcohol addiction, you restore broken marriages, you heal disease and sickness and infirmity. Oh God, you restore sound mind. Oh God, you set people free from depression. You set people free from bipolar disorder. Oh God, you reveal the truth to people, oh God. You restore families, oh Lord. You raise up men and women of God in this place. This is what this place does because of the glory of God through the power of the Holy Spirit. This is what we're called to do. This is what this place is, God. This is your house. This is your house. Breathe new life. Lord, over all our children that we dedicate to you, God. Lord, as we raise them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord, oh Lord. And I pray that you would send them into the heart. Challenge us, oh God, with our finances, Lord, to put you first. faithful managers, oh God, of what you have already given us. Don't check out. Don't check out right now. There's still people here that you need. Jesus loves you so much. Surrender your heart and your life to Him. Surrender your failing marriage to Him. Surrender that backsliding child to Him. Give and ask, oh God, ask. Lord, send them out. Send someone to them, oh God. Oh, we are your people. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord, set a fire in our souls, oh God. Shake us up, oh God. Stir us to the core, oh God. That is all around this place. Lord, I just thank you, God, that we're never too far gone for your grace. Lord, if you can save me, you can save anybody. It doesn't matter about our past. Our past doesn't prevent us from moving forward. Lord, you cleanse us. You redeem us. You renew us. You make us brand new, God. Hallelujah. Isn't the Lord good? Got one amen. Isn't the Lord good?
Amen.
So maybe we're asking, well, where are these harvesters going to come from? And we're praying, Lord, send. Isn't that interesting? Jesus told the disciples, hang with me here, 2 minutes. Jesus told the disciples to pray that the Lord would send out laborers, right? Then who did he tell to go? Told the disciples to go. Look around you. Look around you. This is where the laborers are at. This is where we are. Are you going to have the faith to let the Lord use you? Maybe to do something you don't feel capable of doing. God, I can't step out. I can't talk to anybody. I can't be used. Do you realize? When I was a kid, I used to shake like this whenever I had to talk in front of somebody. And the Lord says, I'm going to use you to do this. Whenever he does that, remember, he always provides the skill that you lack. The reason he's using us in the first place is because he wants to show the world what he can do with somebody that doesn't have any skill. I'm a living example of that. I got no marketable skills. I can talk. That's it. Lord, use this. Lord, use this place to bless the rescue squad, to bless the fire department, to bless the James River Baptist Association, to bless Raipur, India. Guys, the sky's the limit. Remember that. I'm praying the Lord to send out laborers, but I know sooner or later, he's going to put it on my heart. It's time for you to go. When you leave today, folks, you're entering the mission field. You're entering the mission field. Let the Lord use you on that job site. Let him use you in that classroom. Use you in that hospital. Use you in that business meeting, whatever it is. Who's willing? Say, Lord, here we are. Send us. Here we are. Send us. Come on, don't be shy. Lord, use me. You ask, you will receive. Let me pray over you. Lord, I just pray you bless your people. I thank you for such a generous and loving congregation. I thank you for the people here sending me, God. I pray that they would receive a blessing from that. I pray, oh God, that as they go, the Lord, so many of us are timid right now. We're so afraid. Lord, help us to, Lord, I just pray you would break that bondage of fear, oh God. We are children of the Most High God. We are empowered by your Spirit. Help us to walk in faith and do the little things. Just share a loving word with the person next to us that's going through a hard time. Refuse to enter into that conversation that tears somebody else down. Give to the need that we see right next door or right across the street. Help us, oh God. We ask for you to send us out into this harvest field, Savannah County, Scottsville, Virginia. We want it set on fire for Jesus Christ. Bless your people. Give them your peace. Let your face shine on them, God. Lift up your countenance toward them, oh God. Be merciful to them, oh God. Grant them peace. In Jesus' name, amen. Love you so much. Thank you so much for sending me. God bless you.